This is Emma Gold. Welcome to Full Disclosure Now. At 6 p.m. Pacific, 9 p.m. Eastern, live from the Cascadian Ring of Fire, hosted by Yvonne Palermo. We are all beings, groovy little seeds here to feed the planet. Haggy Shack Radio, where the sheep don't sleep and the truth comes from within. HaggyShack.com.
Hey, hey. Oop. Welcome to Looking Out From Within, hosted by Justin Deschamps and myself, Yvonne Palermo. This show will be the last Thursday of every month, 6 p.m. Pacific time, 9 p.m. Eastern, here on Haggy Shack Radio. Please join the open discussion group, Looking Out From Within, on Facebook to contribute to the show's format. The show will focus on a single topic for discussion 30 days prior to airing. A feed is created to generate community questions and information on the topic. The format of the show is to feature a guest relative to the topic that can lend both their personal insight while also engaging with the community through conversation and questions. First hour, we will look at the nuts and bolts information available to the general public. Discuss this with our guest with the intention of educating the listening audience with some grounded facts regarding the topic. In the second hour, folks, the show's format moves to how this topic and the information in the first half relates to the hosts, guests, and listeners on a personal level while also fielding live chat questions on the topic. The intent for the show is to bridge the gap between the literal information about a topic with the internal personal experience regarding how the topic affects you directly. Tonight, my friends, we are tackling the topic of addiction. Physical, emotional, spiritual addiction, big pharma, treatment, black budget funding through the illegal drug trade, and more. Tonight's panel, Justin Deschamps, Stillness in the Storm Newsroom, Emma Gold of Full Disclosure Now, Global Day of Action 1111, and hey, me, Groovy Bean, here, experiencer of light, spreading the Groovy Bean word. We will be taking questions live via chat during the second hour of the show. Listen along, friends, at www.haggyshack.com. Thank you, Colleen Kelly, our producer, for your support with this project. Haggy's Chat Room, friends, is a place where you can express your thoughts, opinions, and concerns freely as long as you do it with respect to all who gather here. The rules are as follows. To comment and ask a question, you must be a registered user, and anonymous folks will not be addressed. All questions in capital letters. Thank you very much, because I'm blind as a bat. Anyhow, last but not least, friends, we are a donation station. The sheep don't sleep here in Haggy's house. So if you like what you hear and you want more of it, show the Babylonian love dove doveys. Click that donate link and follow through. Now, I'm going to read this statement my wonderful friend Justin wrote, and we're going to bring Justin on in. Awakening, or the process of discovering truth in one's life, is a threefold activity. First, we gain awareness of information via research and observation, absorbing raw data at a surface level. Then that information is compared and analyzed against the collective store of our knowledge base. Finally, exploration of what it means with respect to our personal journey takes place. But rarely do we allow ourselves to go past the first step of observation. And even less frequently do we engage in the collective process of truth-seeking, which expands each individual's meanings and insight in a group undertaking of consciousness expansion and upliftment. This radio show, my friends, is intended to serve as a venue to explore this threefold integrative process, what has been called holistic discernment and integration. And friends, I would now love to bring on Justin Deschamps.
Thank you for having me. It's a pleasure to be here. I look forward to our discussion tonight.
Absolutely. I'm glad to be here with you. Woohoo. So,
all right,
my friend, yes.
And do we want to bring in Emma now?
Hey, sure. Why not?
Okay.
We could do that.
I'm already here.
All right.
Hey, you guys.
Hey, Emma, how are you doing tonight?
I'm doing super good. I'm glad that all of us kind of got this together, and it's a great night to kind of kick off the intentions of, you know, connecting with people and opening up on a level of sharing real information about yourself personally, and then also, you know, diving into the knowledge you've acquired along the way and just putting it out there. So I'm happy to share this room and audience with all you guys right now.
Likewise.
Absolutely. All right. I hear Jiminy Cricket.
I was just going to say.
folks, Jiminy Cricket, he's interested too. So come on in, Jiminy. Yes.
Yes, I'm sitting here in the lovely crickets and they're singing their song for us tonight. So that's very nice.
And that's awesome. Magical. Thank you.
So why don't we go ahead and get into what addiction is, and we can flesh out some of the grander aspects of this topic.
Excellent.
Yeah.
Emma, I think you had some nuts and bolts information that you wanted to speak to. Is that right?
Well, I definitely have a lot of different topics I want to cover. You know, addiction is something that's very, very personal to me. It's something I grew up fighting, you know, and continue to still fight to an extent. The habits and the programming and the layers that come along with being an addict. And then it's also something that is a part of my family. It's a part of the social circles that I frequent. It's, you know, it's a part of the world that I live in. And so addiction is one of those things that to me is a real deep subject, and the idea of us getting together here tonight and diving into that, you know, I was moved by previous interviews that Justin and you, Yvonne, have shared together where you guys were open about this stuff. And I think that a lot of people, they go through shame. You know, a lot of people don't quite, you know, understand or relate with addiction. You know, some people, they have not been afflicted with that in their life. And so it is nearly impossible for someone to logically understand addiction or why addicts do the things that they do. And it's also that continuing divide and back and forth that happens between codependency and an addict and a relationship with an addict. Unless you have gone through it yourself, the chances that you'll ever be able to identify with it completely are pretty much zero. And even more so, that's what has contributed to, you know, society turning, you know, the solution over to imprisonment versus treatment, you know, and really kind of looking at incarcerating people for drug offenses versus really looking at what the root problems are and offering treatment. There have been, you know, many progressive countries that have started to include different types of programs to focus on treatment, you know. The Netherlands is one. Canada is starting to do that quite a bit. And even to an extent, the United States is opening up in smaller independent facilities and whatnot. But if you look at even things like alternative therapies with Ibogaine in Mexico, there's a lot of alternative thoughts about how to really approach the topic of addiction and how to heal people. And really, that's at the core, you know. A drug addict is not seeking drugs just for the sensation of getting high. You know, that's somebody that's just using a drug recreationally. A drug addict is seeking drugs to be able to put themselves outside of their own skin, to change the feeling that they have. And when it comes down to it, it's about healing. There's some type of trauma, there's some type of PTSD, there's some type of hole in each addict that is being, you know, trying to be filled with their drug of choice, you know. And really, when it comes down to it, my experience personally was around the healing process and really trying to understand where that hole came from and why I was trying to fill that hole. And so hopefully tonight I'm looking forward to sharing some, you know, some nuts and bolts information about specific things, but also, you know, opening up to my experience and sharing some of my personal life and kind of what I went through and is still going through. And, you know, I'm looking forward to you you two guys contributing and doing the same. And then anybody out in the chat room there or also following along on the Facebook group, looking out from within, there's a feed on the top. Feel free to kind of punch in questions there. I'll be copying and pasting different articles that I'll be referencing from, so people can go and kind of do the research on their own and just kind of look at that. But anybody else who would like to contribute in that feed, that's what it's there for. You know, we're opening up communion to the community here of sharing our experiences, sharing information on a literal level, but also on a personal level. And so that's what we're trying to kick off tonight with this whole radio show program. And happy to be here completely.
Wonderful. Great. Yeah. And let's take a moment before we get into the actual topic to talk about the looking out from within theme of the show. And we'll just take a moment to do this. So basically the idea that we had brainstormed is there's a lot of content out there that is only nuts and bolts, and it doesn't really get into what this means in our personal journeys and the kind of the philosophy of it, which I think is very crucial, because when we learn information, it tends to just sit at the surface and it kind of just becomes a fact that may or may not have any deep meaning. Mm. And it's through that process of really contemplating it and comparing it to all the other information that we have, where the insights about our own personal journey, who we are, and who we're becoming can really blossom. So that's generally the idea that we're trying to bring forth, the theme that we're trying to bring forth with this show, is to present information so that we can all get on the same page as far as what we're talking about. And then once that has been established, then we can really dive into it and suss out some of the bigger, grander spiritual ideas, what this means for us as individuals and what we can do to empower ourselves ultimately to become more who we are and what we're meant to be.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Couldn't have said it better.
Mm-hmm. Beautiful.
Wonderful. Well, I'm going to go ahead and open up the space of vulnerability then and talk about my own personal addiction experience.
Excellent.
And I just want to say that with this topic of addiction, it's not just about drugs. Addiction really, in my view and understanding, is anything that we do unconsciously that satisfies some type of unacknowledged or even denied need inside of us. And we'll get into some of the bigger aspects of that, but I just wanted to mention that it's not just about drugs. That addiction can take on many forms, and we use different words to describe other kinds of addictions, like codependency is essentially a form of addiction. So,
absolutely.
So basically, for those who don't know, I was addicted to heroin and cocaine when I was around 19 to 20 years old is when this started. It began in late 2000, and it started off with opiate addiction. The preamble to this, and I'll try to be as brief as possible, is that I'm bisexual, and I was trying to hide who I was from the world. And this sense of this false identity I was trying to embody was causing me a lot of tension because it wasn't in alignment with who I really was. And because of that, I had a lot of social anxiety. I had a really hard time just talking and being myself around people. And one day somebody came to me and they asked me if I wanted to try OxyContin. And when I tried it like completely melted that feeling of anxiety away inside of me. And for the first time in years, I felt comfortable in my own skin, to kind of echo what you were saying, Emma. So, and that eventually, now looking back, because I was yearning for that stability in my life, emotional level, for so long, it was very easy for me to kind of reach for that same thing every time. So in the beginning, it started off, I would do it, you know, once in a while, and then it became a pretty frequent weekly thing, to the point where every day I was looking for OxyContin. And then eventually it got to the point where I couldn't get that. So somebody said, well, hey, well, why don't you just try heroin? Cause it's pretty much exactly the same thing. And then from there, it was very easy to switch into heroin. And then I ended up going into cocaine later. And I was doing this intravenously. So when you imagine, you know, the worst of the worst kind of addiction to have, like train spotting type of scenario, this is basically was my life for about 3 years. Mm-hmm.
And I was stealing from my friends. I was lying to everybody I could to, you know, obviously hide even more of myself, because not only was I still trying to hide my true nature of in my sexuality, I was also hiding the fact that I was an addict. Mm-hmm. So it kind of compounded the whole problem. And eventually in 2004, I ended up making a conscious choice to get away from that lifestyle. And thankfully, because of my father, he brought me down to Florida, and I was able to be in a situation, in a space that allowed me to transmute or transform these desires for addictions into other urges and satisfactions that were much more healthy and integrated into who I was. And I'll get into those techniques later, but that's essentially my story. So that's my version.
Definitely identify with that. How about you, Yvonne? You want to give us a little?
Oh my, yes, yeah, sure. And thank you, Justin, for sharing that deep part of you, because I understand that. For me, I come from an interesting childhood and a divorced family, and I was always that kid that never fit in. And I started early with alcohol. And through the alcohol and promiscuous behavior that one goes through, which that's another topic. But so from that to the promiscuous behavior, and my first back injury was in my early 20s. Now I'm learning more about myself in my childhood and experiences, and I believe I was born with a predisposition to a bad back. So in my early 20s, I had my first lumbar surgery, and that also brought aboard the narcotics. I found myself using cocaine. I believe that it was mescaline at one point, and that led to more drinking. It really, there was more drinking, more promiscuity, and then more surgeries. I broke my neck in 1998, and from 98 to current, I lost count after 36, 37 surgeries. I have multiple fusions on my spine. I have been a farm slave, a medical slave for a very long time, and it has been a journey of trying to figure out what I'm realizing now is who I am now is the person I was meant to be at the beginning before our structure, and it was the structure that didn't allow me to be me. Because I never fit in. So this escape of using, and it's a realization that there is a lacking emotional nurturing state that leads to a path seeking the soul. Mm-hmm. So the lost parts could be sustained in a cocoon of sorts, right? So now that I look back, I realize I was freezing my light that is within. Since we're talking about looking within.
Yeah.
And I based that on this structured facade that the sheep are in and what I was in. And I realized I just wanted out. We're not given the tools, right? Mm. So to escape from the trauma, the medical trauma, divorce trauma, childhood trauma, and from not fitting within, I believe it fractured the soul, my soul, at the beginning. And it just led me to find a stasis of existence by mind altering and freezing myself in this 3D reality. And it was with that one drink when I was, how old was I? I was in high school. So that was the first start of putting up not walls, but ladders to try to crawl out.
Mm. Mm-hmm. And listening to both you guys, I identify with both of you, you know, putting parts of both your guys' stories. And, you know, there's a there's a peace that washes over you as an addict when you hear other people's stories, because you know that those people can identify. And this is what I was speaking to earlier, is that, you know, there's that divide that happens where people that, you know, don't experience addiction will never understand. And the people that do are the only ones that really can understand. And when you do connect with another addict, that is that sense of peace, that the judgments go out of the window, the connotations of, you know, what it means to be a drug addict goes out the window, because there's somebody sitting in front of you opening up dialogue about the exact same vulnerabilities, you know. And that to me is a big part of how we can heal each other in the community, is opening up like this. And so I'm extending just some sincere gratitude to the both of you for just opening up completely and being vulnerable, and being vulnerable to blindly to a community out there that's listening. You know, that takes a lot, and it's inspiring. So to kind of touch on my experience, you know, I absolutely identify with you, Yvonne, in the way that I just mm-hmm. always didn't feel right here. You know, something mm-hmm. something felt off, but I also identify with kind of early childhood trauma. You know, my first drug of choice was holding my breath, you know, at an age of, you know, 8 or 9. I can remember holding my breath to the point where my lips would turn blue and I would tingle, and it was the sensation of escaping me, you know, escaping the moment. And drug addiction for me has been a long, arduous path, you know, through my mid-20s, where I was able to get clean about 15 years ago. But I started really early on, you know. There were, you know, for me it was huffing gasoline and huffing different types of paints and things like that, moving into, you know, all different types of alcohol, marijuana, psychedelics, methamphetamines. I started using IV drugs when I was about 16 years old. I had moved out of my house at that age and was living on my own, dropped out of school. And my drug experience is woven through also the artistic experience. You know, I'm an artist, and I have been, you know, as long as I can remember. And I've been connected to that journey for as long as I can remember. And there is a part of the kind of the shaman's role that's taken on through artists, I believe, in my experience, where we're kind of tasked with interpreting the ethers, or being antennas for the world, or the voice for the world, and being able to bring it through in a conduit of the medium of our expression. And this is why music and art and all of these things connects so universally, is because people can feel everything that's embodied in those. And it's different to everyone too. Their interpretations are different, but it's a powerful thing. And a big part of that being an artist is carrying that burden sometimes. At least that's how I related to it, is carrying the burden of the world and trying to to figure out how to create a voice for those feelings that you're feeling on an intuitive level all around you. And then on top of that, where do you go to kind of diving into those ethers and bringing out, you know, the stuff from the void that seems to be wanting to come out? And then there is, on that side of things, a real shadow aspect. You know, I believe that when you open yourself up through substances, and especially as a conduit, you are prime territory for darkness to kind of attach itself to you and feed off of you. And a big part of my work, getting clean, was doing a lot of that spiritual work to remove those type of entities and to remove that type of negativity. And, so in a nutshell, you know, my life, was a whirlwind of drug abuse between, you know, about 11 or so until about 25 or 26. And I ended up in Skid Row in downtown Los Angeles, in a hotel called the Cecil Hotel, which is an infamous hotel for a lot of very, very dark things. You know, Richard Ramirez stayed there for a while. There's been these, you know, really horrific murders there and things like that. But I actually had a very beautiful experience there at the end that I'll share with everybody kind of later on in the personal aspect. But that in a nutshell is kind of my experience here around addiction.
Wow. I keyed in on you holding your breath. I just learned about that. So thank you. That is a very interesting.
Definitely a powerful experience. Mm-hmm. Thanks for sharing. Mm-hmm.
It's a real thing for sure. You know, I wanted to share a quote here that I connect with that kind of grounds into the one of the nuts and bolts things of addiction, if you guys don't mind. This is by a writer named Charles Bukowski, which is he's kind of a vulgar writer to say the least, but he's a poet and a storyteller that I have always connected to because he's very much human, and his experience and what he writes about is very much human and very much open and very much vulnerable to all the things that, you know, can be viewed as bad or, you know, horrific or sad or, you know, traumatic. You know, he puts it out there. And he also spent a lot of time or with alcoholism and around communities that were entrenched in the same thing. And this quote is from a book called Women. And, it says, "That's the problem with drinking, I thought, as I poured myself a drink. If something had happened, you drink in an attempt to forget. If something good happens, you drink in order to celebrate. And if nothing happens, you drink to make something happen." And to me, that embodies the place of not feeling comfortable in your own skin. There's something mm-hmm. wrong. That's at the core. There is something wrong. You drink to celebrate. You drink to make something happen. You drink to forget. What is it that drives us addicts to not be able to sit still, to not be able to be who we are? Why, what are we seeking is what I would put mm-hmm. out there to you guys.
Mm. Well, that's an excellent point, because as I was listening to both of your stories, the theme that I pulled out is that we're, each of us in our own way was trying to escape or run from the situation that we were in. Mm. And really, for myself, it was this false identity that I had created for myself that I wasn't brave enough to let go of. And because I wasn't brave enough to let go of, I needed something that I could use to kind of fill in the emotional gap. Mm-hmm. And it seems like that trend of escapism is ubiquitous or is throughout all forms of addiction. What do you guys think about that?
Definitely. Definitely. It's escape. I don't feel like we were given the tools on how to deal with emotions and what we were feeling, or at least for me. Mm. And, you know, even currently, we've got kids still being diagnosed with ADHD, which I was as well. Mm. So first thing you give to them is what? Methamphetamine, right? Or, well, it's like meth, but amphetamine. So this escape, this wanting out, this need, is it the need that we're at this young age and we know that we have this mission, whether you want to call it a star seed or what that is, but then there's no structure to support this creative mind or this thought process. So because we don't fit in, yeah, what did we do? We all want it out. We don't fit in. Something's wrong when there was nothing ever wrong.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Definitely. I definitely connect with that too in the way of just trying to get away. And that's, you know, that goes back to my memories of trying to hold my breath as a kid is I wanted out real early on. You know, I just, this just didn't feel right. And I just, I remember multiple times, you know, wanting to either die or wanting someone to come take me away and just not wanting to be in this experience here. And so when you talk about star seeds in particular, and for those that are listening and don't understand that term, star seed is a term that's used when referencing a soul that's kind of not necessarily from Earth, that's come here from a different either planet or different, you know, different for a different reason other than just the human experience of incarnation here and working through the karma and levels. It's about a soul purpose. And a lot of star seeds that I connect with and talk to have had that same thing of just feeling not, you know, this wasn't right. There's something off here and it doesn't feel right. And so that's kind of a running theme through a lot of star seeds when I connect with them. I wanted to just kind of share some facts that I brought up here on addiction and recovery in general, just to kind of put it out there to the public. This is in relation to Americans' population. Is right now there's 8.9% in need of treatment, and right now that only about 1% is actually getting that treatment. On top of that, when you first go in, 67% of people within that first year, before that first year ends of trying to get sober, end up relapsing. Within 1 to 5 years, 50% of people end up relapsing, and after 5 years, 15% or more end up relapsing. Mm-hmm. And this really just shows, and for the people that have been part of, you know, the treatment circles and programs like AA and different types of rehabs, you see that. You see the turnover happen. You see the continual struggle. And especially when you look at it from an incarceration rate, where you look at people, you know, copping petty offenses, you know, for possession, and then getting so many that they get thrown into jail, you know, eventually in California under like three strikes and things like that, where I have friends that, you know, that are spending 20 plus years right now for small misdemeanor style offenses, or should be misdemeanors in my opinion, for small possession is how I should say it. And this is, you know, this is the experience of trying to get off of drugs doesn't just happen. It doesn't just happen with a flick of a light switch. You go into a program, you know, and then, you know, miraculously you're healed. You know, this is a long, ongoing process. Mm-hmm. And, the turnover rate for people for relapsing is quite high. I'm going to kind of scroll on down here, because there was another section that I thought was very, very interesting. So the relapse rate for these drugs here, and I'm just going to kind of point these all out. For alcohol, overall it's 68%. For hallucinogens, it's 42%. For methamphetamines, it's 52%. For cocaine, it's 61%. For heroin, it is 78.2%. And for marijuana, it's 43%. And when we're talking, for people that don't know, opiates in general, and are related to these high opiate pain medications, like Oxycontin, which is what Justin was talking about, or Opana, or morphine, or Dilaudid, or Percocet, or Vicodin. These are high opiate based, either synthetics or natural combinations that are instantly addictive. These are, in some ways, even mm-hmm. better than the heroin that's available on the streets, definitely. And what happens is when you're prescribed these medications, you know, within 8 to 10 days with some of them, you are a physical addict. That is mm-hmm. just bottom line. That is just the science of it. Your body is physically addicted to that. And when you look at these pharmaceuticals that are being pushed right now for pain, the possibility and the chances that, you know, people are going to come out of that with a serious drug addiction are very, very high, because the strength of these pills are so strong that they rival the street drugs, you know, from which, you know, that they've been kind of modeled after in a way.
Right. Mm-hmm. Let me just add to that real quick by saying, yeah, the basically inside your body, there is a natural narcotic that is produced. It's called endorphins. So if you didn't have this natural narcotic, you'd be experiencing tremendous pain all the time because your nerves would be hypersensitive. So what your body does is it produces this at a balanced level. And when you take opiates, it is a chemical way of forcing a release of this natural neurotransmitter. So when you take heroin, for example, it forces this neurotransmitter to constantly pour out. So you end up feeling not necessarily numb, but you just feel good. You literally feel, it's almost like the best way I can describe it, just to put it in context for people, is it's that experience like you're eating your favorite food, and you know, you're in a family dinner and everything is just perfect and everything just feels just so amazing and like nothing can touch you. That's what that feeling is.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And it's literally like wrapping a warm blanket of mother's love around you. I mean, mm-hmm. it's really amazing how powerful it is. And the reason why Emma was saying it can be almost instantly addictive is once that chemical is inside your body, your natural process for releasing these endorphins starts to pull back because your body's interested in maintaining balance. So if you're feeding opiates into your body, then your body's going to reduce the release of these natural endorphins, which means if you stop taking the opiates, there's going to be a period of time where you have no natural narcotic flowing through your body. And this is what is called the detox experience, or when people have, you know, this cold sweats and they feel like their skin's jumping out, or they get very sick for a week. And this is why it's a biologically addictive, in addition to its psychological addictive properties. Just wanted to throw that out there.
Definitely.
Mm-hmm. And I would like to add, if it's okay, real quick, we went over the opiates. I don't want people to forget, because I part of my big, I mean, the main addiction for me was to Soma and benzodiazepines.
Yeah, definitely.
And benzodiazepines, for listeners, if you don't know, Xanax, Paxil, Clonopin, Valium, Diazepam, Lorazepam, Ativan. I can just, but Soma was right there. Yeah.
And those drugs too, and when taken in combination with opiates, is a very common thing on the street, you know, because they enhance each other's effects. If you're to take a benzo with an opiate, it's that much stronger, and it's also that much more lethal, you know. It's in I just posted within the feed for anybody that's following along on the Facebook group, looking out from within, the article that I was pulling those facts from. And within there is a lot of different pieces of nuts and bolts inventory that or information that you guys can kind of troll around and research for yourself. But one of the pieces of information in there was that what is the percentage? It's a very high percentage that of deaths have to do with combinations. It's combinations of drugs, you know. It's, they call it poly drugs. Here it is. More than 50% of overdose deaths involve two or more drugs in a poly drug abuse. And you know, this is something that's, you go down the road of addiction and you start combining them because you start looking for the stronger effects. Your body builds up a tolerance, you know, especially with opiate addiction and alcoholism, you know, and your body builds up a tolerance to it. So you're continually having to use more. You're continually having to find creative ways, whether you're combining cocaine and heroin together for a different effect, whether you're combining, you know, Oxycontin with Soma, you know, you're looking to really kind of get the strongest impact as possible. And that comes out of your body's natural kind of buildup and defense and, you know, being able to have a tolerance against the drugs in general.
Yes, and I do just want to remind folks tuning in, we will address your questions in the second part of the show, so keep them coming. Thank you.
Absolutely. You know, one of the things I wanted to kind of bring up here too is the treatment versus incarceration topic, you know, and there is a great report that was put out by the Justice Policy Institute titled Treatment versus Incarceration, which I'll also link on the feed here. And it breaks down, you know, logically and, you know, mathematically as far as funding, the cost of incarcerating somebody versus the cost of treatment, and how in America, particularly the way that we go about the drug problem here, the drug epidemic here, is to arrest and incarcerate. And the facilities that are available to drug addicts, one, if you don't have insurance, it's incredibly hard to get into. You know, the wait times are very long. The quality of treatment is subpar to an extent. You know, if you don't have insurance, you're pretty much left to, you know, these long waiting lines and having to submit yourself to, you know, different types of testing to be able to actually get into these treatment facilities. And so it speaks to the epidemic also for the need of looking at reform for how we actually deal with the drug epidemic in general, you know. And I kind of wanted to kind of put that out to you guys here within this article. There it touches on treatment can be less expensive than the term of imprisonment. Treatment can be cost effective. Treatment can reduce substance abuse and relapse rates while building communities, and drug treatment can be more effective than cycling people in and out of prison. The article is very in depth. The report is there, and you guys can follow up on the group here. Do you guys have any kind of contribution to that topic there?
Yes.
I actually think this would be a great point to talk about some of the deeper causes of addiction to set the context for why some treatments work versus others.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, well, in anticipation of that, there is a lot of great information to go through. So, but basically, there's a couple key points I want to bring up. First of all, there's a researcher named Dan Winter, and he has a device called the Heart Tuner, which it combines EEG and EKG readouts. So an EEG is an echoencephalograph, which actually measures your brain waves, and an EKG is an echocardiogram, which measures your heart. And these are both electromagnetic waves that are emitted from your heart and brain. Now, what the device does is it measures how well the two are integrated, which is the word for that integration, or you could even say, like, how well they're dancing in step with each other. Mm. Okay, the word for that is called coherence. So when there is a high level of coherence, they're dancing in step with each other almost at every turn, whereas when there is not a lot of coherence, the heart and mind are almost not integrated at all.
Mm.
And what's very interesting and profound is that he hooked this machine up to people and he measured them. And he did a study where he measured people before they were feeling cravings or their yearning for an addictive tendency like smoking cigarettes or maybe checking their cell phone or something like this. And what he noticed was just before the person experienced this craving, the level of dissonance or the lack of coherence between the heart and brain was at an extreme level, meaning the heart and brain were almost completely disconnected from each other. But after the person got that thing that they wanted for their addictive tendency, the reverse was caused. They experienced an extreme level of coherence, more so than when they were just sitting around being normal.
Hmm.
So what that suggests is that the thing that we yearn for at an addictive level is much like a talisman. So people don't know what a talisman is. It's an object or something in reality that we assign a meaning to that we use to invoke a state of consciousness within ourselves.
Hmm.
So, for example, if you pray over the Bible because you think the Bible is very connected to God and source and consciousness, well, that object for you is a talisman. Just the mere presence of that object is going to invoke a change of consciousness inside of you.
Hmm.
So what we're essentially describing here and what Dan was able to prove through using this device is that addictive tendencies, what's actually happening is we're using the addictive behavior to unconsciously change our consciousness. Let me say that again with less words that use consciousness. When we do our addictive behavior, we're using it as a kind of a formula or a process or a ritual that changes something inside of us, either our perspective or our state of being. And it's something that we normally do not have conscious control over. So, for example, if you need a drink every time you get out of work because work is so frustrated, okay, well, that feeling, mm-hmm. that change inside of you that actually is affected by drinking the beverage is a shift in your consciousness that can be measured. So what you get out of your addiction in that sense, the effect, isn't necessarily bad, okay? The reason you're even yearning for it in the first place is because there's something inside of you, as Emma was talking about earlier, there's a hole that needs to be filled. And because we lack the conscious process or technique to do that properly, we turn to something outside of us as a dependency.
And where, when you talk about the talisman aspect, can you give me a personal relation in your life to that, just to kind of ground people into that understanding? I think that's it's a really brilliant point to kind of bring up, and also a really great metaphor in the way of using the symbolism and the idea of a talisman, Justin. And so is there any way you could kind of connect on a personal level of sharing with people that, how that related with you and your experience?
Yes, definitely. Well, let me first say that effect that I'm talking about, the talismanic effect,
Mm-hmm. It's much bigger than just one or two things. It's not that only some things are talismans and everything else is something else. It's literally everything in our experience. Everything from the thoughts we think to the sensations we feel to the objects we touch and the people we meet, all of that can be considered a talisman. And all a talisman is a symbol that we, that it causes us to feel a meaning or change our consciousness. Hmm. So at a personal level for me, I really noticed this when I recently started to pay attention to my diet and why I ate the certain foods that I did. And to kind of give you a little background, so my normal process in the morning is I wake up, I do a little work, and I usually fast throughout the first 3 hours of the day. And what happens is I start to do work and I get kind of antsy about an hour and a half in, and then I get an impulse or an urge to have tea, to have coffee, to have something to eat, something to give me a little pep or a boost. Okay.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So that little pep or a boost that I'm talking about, that is the talismanic effect.
Mm-hmm.
So I think everybody can relate to this. You know, when you wake up in the morning, you know, what do most people reach for? They reach for either coffee, or maybe if they're a smoker, they reach for a cigarette, or, you know, whatever it is.
Mm-hmm.
And ask yourself, why are you doing this? What do you get out of this activity that mm-hmm. you do?
Very powerful.
Definitely.
Mm.
Yeah.
Well, when we're talking, go ahead, Justin. What I was going to say is...
All right, I'll continue my spiel in a minute here. Go ahead.
Well, I just definitely relate with that in the context of the talisman in all different parts, because, you know, the idea of it, you know, basically essentially being a trigger, you know, in certain areas, you know, and that's something that's terms that they use within, you know, the kind of recovery circles is triggers in your life. What triggers you? And they, you know, they talk about taking you out of the environment that does trigger you, or, you know, being able to kind of manage those triggers completely, and so that's why I identified with the idea of a talisman in that way too. You know, that totally makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
Right on. Okay, so now that we know that an addictive behavior is literally like a magical ritual for changing our state of consciousness, mm-hmm. we have to ask ourselves, well, what are we trying to change? Why are we even trying to change the consciousness in the first place? And this is where the idea of trauma comes into play. So mm-hmm. let me define what trauma is. So trauma is a state where we at some level choose to dissociate from our experience. So we're feeling something that we don't want to feel. And because we choose not to feel it, we literally start to pull away from our experience. And this causes us to feel negative emotions associated with trauma. So I would say a really good example of this is the feeling of being cold. Okay, most people don't like the feeling of being cold. And when they feel this sensation on their body, because of this learned response of maybe when you were younger, you had something happen where you got really cold and it made you really uncomfortable. So now you at that point, you chose in your own mind, and it probably wasn't even conscious, to say, I don't like this. And then the next time you felt that cold, you literally felt like a recoiling in your, right. in your beingness, you know, and then it can get to the point where just even the slightest hint of feeling cold can make you feel this reaction, like you're almost immersed in this cold water.
Mm-hmm.
Another really good example is smells. So when you first smelled something that may not have been desirable to you, it may not have evoked this huge reaction. But because you chose to say, I don't like this smell, I don't want to experience this smell, it's literally your free will at a fundamental level of consciousness is choosing to try to pull itself out of the living experience. And when it does this, a dissociation happens. And this is where trauma comes in. So this means that, let's say if you hate the smell of broccoli cooking, for example, maybe the first time you smelled it, you're like, oh, well, I don't really like that smell. And then the next time you're like, oh, I really don't like the smell. And then after years, it gets to the point where just smelling the smell of cooking broccoli can almost make you nauseous to the point where you have to leave the room.
Mm.
Okay, so all of these are effects of trauma. And what's happening at a spiritual level is that our consciousness, that thing that actually connects us to the fleshly, earthly reality, is trying to like run out of our body. Mm. Okay, and when this happens, the subconscious takes over, because what the universe is trying to do is it's trying to do the reverse. It's trying to get you to completely invest yourself 100% into what you're doing. And when you choose not to do that, when you choose to pull out of your experience, the universe has to like balance the equation, and it does this through the experience of negative emotions, which then need to, because we experience things that we deem to be negative, we want to alleviate that, and that causes this hole inside of us. So now we want to alleviate that through either drugs or through watching TV or talking to our friend or whatever the thing is that we choose to bring us comfort. Mm-hmm. And the one thing I want to say is, just because you have the desire to feel comfort doesn't mean you're a bad person or anything like that. It just means that there's something inside of you that at some point in your life you haven't completely accepted. Mm. So, sorry, were you going to say something?
Definitely relate with that for sure.
Mm-hmm. Right on. So just to finish this little spiel is, I wrote out a few notes that I just want to read to hopefully set the context for this. And it starts off with the spiritual self and the evolving self. The interplay between the two is what actually creates the potential for addictive behaviors and impulses. So when the spiritual self is denied from actualizing via free will choice, the subconscious will try to seek and satisfy that urge via an impulse or an addictive behavior, which restores balance to the soul in the evolutionary process. So think about it like this. Our spiritual self, our higher self, is that perfectly complete, evolved version of ourselves. And the part of who we are right now, we're like reaching towards that. We're walking towards that ultimate goal. And the universe is working with us to try to do that. It's giving us opportunities and experiences to facilitate that process. And the thing that we have control over is the free will choice. So in a way, it's like the universe is putting out a buffet platter of different options, and we get to choose which option. And ultimately, the goal is always going to end up in the same place, but we get to decide how we're going to get there. And when we choose not to actualize our spiritual self, well, that what we deny about ourselves manifests outside of us as fate. And in this case, it manifests outside of us as an unconscious or addictive behavior. So in that sense, addiction within this definition is an unconscious or uncontrollable desire for something that satisfies a spiritual need, which by nature of the unconscious suppression is beyond our control. The effect of our consciousness of this thing, which is rightly called the talismanic effect, is what needs to be identified and shifted to a conscious process. So basically what I'm talking about, to try to boil it down, is that the very fact that you have impulses and addictive tendencies means that there's a part of you that is trying to become actualized, that is trying to be realized. And it hasn't. And in a way, the very fact that you see the fact that you have an addiction is an amazing blessing, because now you know that there's something inside of you that can be healed and reconciled. And I'll leave it at that for now, and we can talk about treatment methods and whatnot in a moment.
Justin, did you ever see that movie Scanners, where the guy's head just explodes? That was some seriously deep stuff you just laid down, and mm-hmm. I totally connect with all of that, you know, as that process. It's so deep, I'm just kind of like sitting here in this coma of really kind of absorbing it. But I think you nailed it in a really cohesive, eloquent way to kind of tie a lot of different questions together, at least for an addict. You know, I can totally relate with everything that you're saying there. And, you know, one of the things that you brought up was about the, you know, the trauma and what that is. is, and trauma is such a huge part of the recovery process, you know, is really kind of getting down and dealing with the trauma of that. What was the starting trauma that happened that maybe led you down this path? Yvonne, you spoke about, you know, having a hard childhood. I can definitely relate with certain aspects of that. What was the trauma that was, you know, incurred along the way of that? You know, you talk about being a drug addict, like, that's a pretty traumatic experience, or at least mine was. I had to do some, you know, pretty crazy things out there and hurt, you know, quite a few people. And there was a lot of trauma coming out of that in recovery that, you know, had to be kind of looked at and dealt with. And so for me, like, you know, when I look at like, okay, if, you know, a friend was to come to me, which many have, and, you know, have asked, you know, can I get some help or can you help me, give me some perspective? You know, that's the first thing I tell them to look at is, you know, what are you guys running from? What is the trauma? How do you start healing? You know, where does your internal compass point to the wounds that need to be mending there? You know, and it's, that goes to the root of recovery in general and also different types of treatments. One of the treatments that I haven't experienced, but I've been very, very interested in hearing about, or anybody that's listening has any kind of experience with this, or you know, knows of anybody, is ibogaine. And ibogaine is a hallucinogenic drug that comes from Africa. It's derived from the root of the bark on the root of the ibogaine shrub or plant. And it is essentially a very, very strong hallucinogenic with the effects that last, you know, between 24 or 36 hours. And currently it's completely illegal in most countries. Right now, Mexico has, you know, a handful of clinics that have opened up and offered the treatment to people looking to, you know, kind of get help and seek help. And what I have heard and what I have watched on documentaries, and I'll put some information here in the room for anybody that wants to follow up with this, is that people that have gone in and out of the rooms of, you know, AA, or people that have, you know, gone into different types of treatment and continually cannot stay clean or continually not get down to the bottom of it, have been, you know, miraculously transformed through this process. And ibogaine, the way they describe it is you are taken back to the sources of your trauma in a kind of a shamanistic spiritual experience. You know, anybody that's taken psychedelics knows that, you know, there's something to that veil being lifted with the use of those substances there. And ibogaine essentially does, you know, what ayahuasca or, you know, toad serum or any one of those kind of heavy hallucinogenics that are part of, you know, shamanistic rituals and beliefs do, which is bring you in and commune with the mother, commune with everything. And really, the when I look at the descriptions for people's different ibogaine trips and how they healed them, it's taking them back to the root of their trauma. It's taking them back and looking at it and seeing it and you know, shining a light on it and seeing, you know, what little shadows try to scurry off it when you shine a light on them, and really kind of working through it on a psycho-spiritual level in a really intense experience. And at the end of that trip, that journey, you know, supposedly the accounts are people have no need to, have no desire to. That trauma has been cleared from them there, and everything that they've done through, you know, 12 steps or different programs or different medications to help them ease off, it's not needed, you know, it's not needed. There is something that was reset with them, you know, through this experience of ibogaine that, you know, that was able to address the trauma on multiple levels and allow them to kind of work through that on multiple levels.
Mm-hmm. Mm. And soaking this in, I'm thinking about the trauma itself and, to go to, you know, surgeries. I've had several, many, many, many. And thinking about what you said about the disassociation and that goes with the trauma. And every surgery, you know, at the beginning, the smell of the hospital, the bings and the bongs and the noises of the hospital, the doors of the hospital, the smell of the patient gown, I could tell you exactly which medicines they were going to give me beforehand just based on the smell of it. The trauma that's involved just surgically, knowing you're going to have surgery, you could come out paralyzed over and over or just dead. And, what I had to get a grip on is not to disassociate and to tell them I need to physically walk into the surgical room on my 2 feet and be in control, to sit on that gurney, to look at the room that my body is going to lay in. I want to see everybody's face in that room, and then you can put that mask on me. I took control as best as I could, so I stopped disassociating in that moment. And when I did that, it was amazing how empowering the advocacy for myself doing that, and to my looking within my inner being, how learning that for myself, that it's okay to take control of this emotion, to be in this moment and be in that now, not to worry what might be, not to stress the night before the surgery, but to take control of that dance of the surgery and the event, to make that disassociation go away.
Right. Yeah, I think that perfectly exemplifies what the principle Emma was just speaking to with the, I forget the name, but the drug that's like ayahuasca.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and to echo what I was just mentioning earlier about the causes, you know, trauma is you losing grip. It's you literally trying to run away from your own experience. And so it literally, within your own mind, it creates a hole of understanding. You lack consciousness with something. Mm-hmm. And that hole of understanding needs to be filled. That's really when we talk about treatment, the difference between an effective treatment and an ineffective treatment is that we're actually addressing the foundational causes, which is a lack of an integrated being due to trauma. So, you know, a lot of when we talk about treatment, it's focused only on the behavior of the addiction, whether it's alcohol or drugs or gambling or food or whatever it is. Okay. It's behavior, but the behavior is really a symptom of a greater issue. And that greater issue is basically the being that we create through our choices is not in alignment with who we really are. And we came here for a specific purpose. And a deep spiritual part of us knows that. And when we are denying that aspect of ourselves from manifesting itself in all of the experiences we have, including the ones that we think are mundane or that we can't make sense of, it leads to a potential for leading to addictive behavior. So at this point, we're right about the midway point of the show, and I think this is a good place to take a break, and then we'll probably come back. I'll finish my little spiel about treatment and how to actually affect positive treatment in your own lives, and then we can maybe take some calls.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
I believe. There we go.
All right, welcome back, everybody. This is the second hour of Looking Out From Within. Mm-hmm. With myself, Justin Deschamps, we have Yvonne Palermo and Emma Gold.
Howdy, howdy.
Hi, hi.
And we are continuing our discussion about addiction. So in this hour, we're actually going to go ahead and take calls. And before we do that, I'm just going to finish the information presentation portion.
I'm going to correct you there, Justin. We're going to take live chat questions instead of calls.
Oh, yes,
yep.
That.
Yep, it's all good.
And I realized while we were in break that I forgot to do an intro that I like to do before any time I speak on the radio, which is let everybody know that the information I present is based on my own personal research and understanding and is not meant to be taken as gospel or believed blindly. I'm not a guru. I'm not some ascended master, or I'm not an insider or anything like that. And I strongly implore everybody to do their own research, vet out and verify all everything I talk about so you can have your own personal understanding.
Ditto on that page.
Yep. Yep. Yep.
Okay, great. Okay, so we were going to get into treatment, and in the previous section we were talking about the causes, the foundational causes behind addictive behaviors or impulses, something that we do that is seemingly beyond our control, yet satisfies some need within us or we wouldn't do it. So in order to really understand this, I feel like we have to realize that the mind is programmable. So our human nature is such that we can be programmed like a computer, but that isn't to say that we actually are a computer. Okay. And the really cool thing or the empowering thing is that when we're ready and when we're able, we can actually program ourselves. That's actually like our destiny, so to speak. Mm. Okay. So the interesting aspect is when we're not programming ourselves, reality itself is programming us at an unconscious level. So you can't really get away from the programming. You either take the reins and start managing your own life and doing your own programming, or life tells you what's happening. Mm-hmm. Okay, so the addictive behaviors are already established programs. And they're programs for satisfying, as we discussed earlier, some kind of need. I would argue all addictive behaviors are all founded at some deep spiritual need, but actually knowing what that spiritual need is kind of difficult. So it's easier to lay claim to either a physical or an emotional need. So for example, I'm going to use myself. I used to drink a lot more coffee than I do now, but it was literally like a 2, 3, 4 cup a day kind of coffee person. Mm. And I relied on the coffee because I'm a blogger and I spend most of my time sitting around not being too physical. And as a result of that, my dopamine levels can kind of get low. I can feel lethargic. I lose motivation. And coffee, especially the sugar that I put in it, was a nice way to give myself a good pep of dopamine. Mm-hmm. Okay. So the effect that we're trying to get to is the feeling of inspiration. All right. So basically I was using the coffee as a substitute for a way to feel inspired and motivated and really invested in what I was doing.
I think a lot of people relate with that.
Okay, good. I'm trying to pick a good example that everybody can relate to. So what I realized was that it wasn't enough to just simply tell myself, I'm not going to drink as much coffee today. Because in your mind doesn't really understand negative affirmations. All it hears is the positive aspect of the statement. So in my mind, when I tell myself, I'm not going to drink coffee today, I'm not going to drink coffee today, my mind hears, I'm going to drink coffee today, I'm going to drink coffee today. Okay? So the trick is, or the technique is to create a new behavior that is equal to the impulse that we had used. So it's not, as Buckminster Fuller says, the only way to, where's the quote? I actually found it. As Buckminster Fuller says, you never change things by fighting the existing reality. To change something, build a new model that makes the existing model obsolete. I would say that short little sentence is the magic bullet behind every addictive, impulsive, unconscious behavior you have in your life.
Definitely. I can relate with that for sure.
Yeah. So, I mean, so to bring my example back here, what I started doing was I observed the fact that I had an addictive tendency. I recognized the truth. So I had to gain knowledge of something. I had to admit to myself that I had something, I was doing something that was beyond my control, which I would argue is probably the hardest step. Because a lot of the things that we do in our lives, we justify, like, well, I have to do this, I have to do that. And in the realm of even thinking about maybe there could be another way never even enters into our minds. Mm-hmm. Okay? So just getting to the point where you can actually acknowledge the fact that you have some kind of impulse or addictive behavior is arguably the biggest step. Mm-hmm. Then, at that point, now what you have to do is you have to create a new behavior, a new thought. So for myself in this process, what I started to do was I started to stop drinking coffee and sugary drinks in the morning, and instead I would do push-ups and calisthenics and yoga. And hold on, I'm getting a – okay. I just got a message that Skype dropped. So it looks like we're back. So the reason – I want to explain this because from a biological level, the thing – okay, I got really scrambled, so I'm just going to – I don't know where we got cut off, so I'm just going to repeat kind of what I was saying here. I was getting into the idea of creating a new behavior to override the addictive behavior, okay? And this gets to the idea that we can't really change an existing reality. By denying it, we have to actually make something new. So – for myself, in my desire to transcend my addictive tendency towards coffee, which I was drinking about 4 or 5 cups of at one point, I decided to do push-ups and yoga and calisthenics. And the reason why is because at a biological level, it releases the same type of feeling that I would get out of drinking coffee, and especially the sugar. So the sugar, at a biological level, it reduces a huge amount of dopamine and serotonin into your brain. Then you feel good. You feel this buzz like, oh, man, I'm ready to take on the world. Okay. And you get that same feeling when you push your body to the point of physical exertion. That's when you get HGH, human growth hormone release, which mm-hmm. releases all sorts of other neurotransmitters. Okay. So the key point to walk away from here is I created a new behavior. I had to actually think about and imagine, okay, well, what can I do to replace this that empowers me instead of disempowers me? Mm. Okay? And then once I did that, and the first step is usually the most difficult because the thing that you always have been doing is the thing that you're always going to want to continue to do. And the crazy part is you do it at an unconscious level. So I would literally be to the point where I'd wake up in the morning and I'd be in the kitchen and I'm going through the motions of making the coffee and I'm not even thinking about what I'm doing. I'm like off in this whole other place.
Mm.
It's like my body is like at an automatic level. It's literally carrying out the running the program of drinking coffee.
Definitely.
So in order to override that, I had to force a new behavior onto top of that, which means in the process of doing this, I'm still feeling the impulse to drink coffee. Mm-hmm. But instead of choosing to go with that impulse, I choose to put energy into the new behavior.
Mm-hmm.
And during the transition, the impulse is still going to be really strong to the point where it may seem like, oh my God, I can't think of anything but what my impulse is. Mm-hmm. But the key is to just keep pouring conscious mental energy into the new behavior. So what I do is I imagine myself doing the yoga and push-ups and I imagine feeling amazing and happy and filled with vitality and just loving life. And I'd sit there and I'd literally imagine this like vision of myself doing this. And then I'd act on that vision and get feedback. And I actually got a positive experience. Mm. And then eventually you get to the point where that new behavior replaces the old behavior.
Mm-hmm.
And it's now to the point where even if you put a cup of coffee in front of me, I mean, I still like the coffee, but I'm not as, like, unconsciously drawn to it as I was in the past. Okay.
Yes.
So that's
Rebuilding, rebuilding, you know, the platforms on top of those habits is essential. And it's a way of, you know, so many people just try to fight it. You know, so many people, you just try to fight it. And to an extent, that's an unwinnable war. And so the consciousness of what you're extending in your own experience here, Justin, as far as how you related that to a different physical activity and you started transmuting that there is an incredible way to do that. And I can totally relate with it in the way that, you know, when I was in rehab, I could barely walk. I went cold turkey from, you know, heroin in a big way, and I could barely walk, you know, in 3 days, 4 days into it, could barely sleep. And my bunkie at the time, you know, basically dragged me out of bed and forced me to hit the weight pile, and I could barely pick up a 10-pound dumbbell. I mean, barely at that point. And day after day after day, going through and you know, just doing that physical exertion there, but also replacing the habit. Because when you're a drug addict, or when you're, you know, an addict in general, those habits are daily. Those habits, you know, hourly, maybe even, you know, by the minute to a certain extent. And so what Justin's talking about as far as kind of replacing those altars in a way and rebuilding them oriented into something that's healthier, that serves you in, you know, an upward direction in a positive way in your life instead of tears you down is a great way to kind of trick or transmute that existing kind of program that is there. I think that's brilliant.
Right. So like, and I'm sorry I cut out on the call a little bit, but we recently had Dr. Saeeda Desilay on, and that, I believe that's even what we're talking about here. For me, you know, sugar, I extremely was addicted to sugar. And you're not necessarily saying no because you're saying yes to something else. So to retrain the brain that way, I'm saying no to sugar, but hey, I'm saying yes to honey. So it's not necessarily saying no, because there is a yes. It's just a healthier choice. Yes.
Absolutely.
Right, exactly. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and just to finalize this is it's the same basic method I used when I got off of the bigger drugs back in 2004. In November of 2004, I moved to Florida, and I spent a year literally just filling notebooks with insights and unearthing my experience, really trying to discover who I was. And at the time, I didn't really know what I was doing, but looking back, I realized that I was integrating all of these parts of myself that I had spent years trying to deny. And it's that, really, the key technique behind all of the different methods is all about integrating your experience into yourself. So that you can actually become who you are meant to be, and that's a creative process. So whatever your addiction is, it has to be a conscious process of actually bringing all of these things in your life that maybe you haven't fully explored or you've even rejected. Really honor that. Like, honor yourself. Mm-hmm. Honor what's happened in the past. Embrace that. Feel gratitude that it is a part of the process that will eventually lead towards transcendence.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Yes. You know, and I look at it as a place of, you know, whittling wood, that you're continually shaving off layers and getting deeper to refining that masterpiece that's inside there. You know, each one of us have master abilities when we're kind of brought into this world here to shape and craft our experience. And, you know, also the knowledge that we gain along the way and contribute to the whole and to the cosmic knowledge. And each little victory, each little, you know, lesson learned, each one of those places are a chip off of that wood block, you know, as you're kind of refining that and creating that manifestation of the most brilliant life that you can experience, the most brilliant manifestation of love and beauty and creation that you can kind of put forth in this time in this lifetime. So I feel you on all that stuff.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. And that just makes me think that the other thing is, if you start trying to tackle an addiction, don't beat yourself up if you relapse.
Absolutely.
You know, all that means is that you still got more work to do. And in reality, the fact that you can now be conscious of that, like I was mentioning before, being conscious is probably the hardest step.
accept that, honor it, and realize that it's the process that is becoming perfect. It's the goal isn't even as much as important as what you're doing right now in your process to get there.
Definitely. And I can, you know, again, from a personal experience, because we're kind of in that part of the show here, you know, where I got clean was actually in Skid Row. I ended up there. But then where I chose to kind of get clean was to walk into an indigent, you know, homeless shelter slash rehab. And, you know, I spent 90 days in there at my own will. And then I chose to stay in the community after that and live in a small SRO in front of the same hotel that I walked past the same dope dealers every single time. And again, this is my experience and I wouldn't suggest this to anyone, but to me, my life has been a, you know, pretty damn extreme, and I do things on a pretty extreme level. And so from that place of getting sober and getting clean in the same environment that I existed in the darkest spaces that I could be really allowed me to kind of rewire myself in a way really fast and in a really strong way. It, you know, every single day having to see the same dope dealers, the same, you know, the same areas, the same people using, that actually strengthened me. And it got to a place where it wasn't long where I didn't ever think about it in that context of, oh man, should I go out and, you know, is it a possibility I should go out and, you know, just chip or get a little bit or just do it once? Like, you know, being a drug addict for me, it's something I'll never forget, you know. It's something that lives with me every day. I still have dreams about shooting heroin. I still, you know, have daydreams about buying heroin. This is something that I live with every single day. And that, and I accept it. I accept it. Yeah. And when I stop fighting it and I just kind of accepted that that's going to be a part of me, that's when it became not so scary. A lot of people that are getting off of drugs, it's terrifying to relapse. And going back to what Justin said here is it's important to, you know, if you do relapse, to get back up. You know, how many times did you fall off your bicycle and skin your knees before you got there and learned how to do it and felt confident? And still, you know, the chances of you getting out there and slamming into something, not paying attention, that's life. But it's, you got to pick yourself back up and continually go at it. And for me, the experience of understanding my drug addiction was a gift in the way that it really dove me deeper into a lot of different areas of trauma. And it's made me start to kind of look at why I didn't feel comfortable here. And, you know, what is that? What is that about? And that's a personal journey, you know, that is so important to continue to follow. And I know from the outside, people that are dealing with relatives and loved ones, addiction is a nightmare, you know. It is a nightmare, and it's also a hurricane where it sucks everybody into it, you know. And one of the things that, you know, my mother and, you know, people close to me had to accept is that, you know, he may die. He may die. And there is a place where everyone stops enabling and stops, you know, contributing, where for me, that was it. That's where it really unplugged me, and I started going down to the spiral of really kind of hitting rock bottom and really kind of going, all right, there's no place to go from here but up, you know. When it is so hard to see somebody suffering and in need and, you know, can I have $20 or can I stay here for tonight or can you go have a drink with me or any of those things, you naturally, humans, you want to comfort each other, you want to bring, you know, joy. And when you see somebody suffering, you want to alleviate that. And that is this role of ping pong codependency that goes on between, you know, the drug addict and the people that care about him or her. And so my experience is that it wasn't until everyone let go to leave me to my own journey was I able to really do my own journey and get to the bottom and build myself back up from that. And that whole process was, you know, like riding a bike, skinning my knees. It wasn't easy. It didn't come like a flick of a switch overnight and I was healed. I'm still actively healing every single day moving forward. You know, it is what it is.
Right.
And I do want to bring in, we do have a listener, Nova Fiction, and thank you. This is applying to your question, and Nova Fiction had asked, at what point did you make the choice to heal instead of continuing the addictive behaviors? What made you make that choice? So.
Justin, you want to take that first?
Sure. For myself and my own personal experience, there was a point where I was comforting myself and I realized I was doing this. Thankfully, while I was going through this addictive time in my life where I was on heroin and cocaine, I always kind of knew what was happening. Like, as much as I was trying to deny my sexuality and deny who I was and just try to cover myself in a warm blanket of drugs, mm-hmm. Behind all that, it's like my conscience was saying, come on, Justin, you know better. You know, and eventually it took 3 years, basically. It took 3 years of me living that lifestyle, of accumulating all of the experiences that came with it, where I finally, the path of least resistance was no longer in being a drug addict. Mm-hmm. Now that was more resistance than choosing not to be a drug addict.
Mm-hmm.
So I would say that, instead of trying to beat yourself up about the fact that you maybe still have an addictive tendency, realize that it is a step in the road towards recovery.
Mm-hmm.
And that when you finally make that choice, it's usually because you take a step out of your own maelstrom or the storm of your own life to find a place of stillness so that you can actually look from a clear head and ask yourself, what do I really want? What is more important to me? This temporary satisfaction I get from my addictive behavior, or yearning for something that is unknown right now, but will give me much more peace of mind, equanimity, confidence, satisfaction, etc. That was the moment for me.
Mm. For me, I went to rehab twice. And the first time, honestly, the reason why I went to rehab was I was out of drugs. And I knew that I was most likely going to die because of the amount of benzodiazepines and the alcohol I was drinking. So honestly, that's why I went the first time. There was no will behind it. Oddly enough, at that time, Soma, the one of the main drugs, it's not necessarily benzodiazepine, but it did get classified, because it wasn't at that time. And this was 7 years ago, when I got out of detox, they handed me back the Soma because at that time it was not classified.
Mm.
So I came out detoxed, but they handed me it right back. And I was like, woohoo, honestly. I was like, cool, I can take this. And sure enough, I took it in the car going home. Now, the second time that I went in, and that this was 2 years later, there was that voice that said, you know what, this job, it could, because it's a job to be an addict. I was tired. I was tired of this job.
Yeah.
And the will, that little beacon, that little voice inside stepped up to the plate and said, I'm done. This is enough. You either just go ahead and die or step up to the plate. That is which life is, because you are here for a reason. So you need to go. And that's what led me to the second time. And then I detoxed very much longer than normal because of this amount of the benzos. And then I did go into the rehab program after. And that was interesting, but, and here, you know, 5 years, it'll be 5 years this August.
Yeah.
So there you go.
Mm-hmm. That's awesome.
Right on.
And I can totally relate with you too, you know, Yvonne, on that level. You know, for me, that point was death, you know, of wanting to die. And my experience, you know, I ended up in the Cecil Hotel, which is a very notorious hotel for, you know, drugs and prostitution in Skid Row in downtown Los Angeles. And I had romanticized that kind of death. Okay. Like, if I'm going to take, you know, this experience to the extreme, then so be it. This is where I'll end up. I'm ending up in kind of the worst of the worst situations. And I pretty much, you know, over a period of 3 weeks went went through the last little bit of money that I had burned out all of my, you know, family connections. Nobody knew where I was. Nobody knew if I was alive or dead. And I was committed to dying in that hotel. And the last part of my, you know, drug addiction was cooking a shot for myself that was so large it should have took me out, you know, and that was it. And I had planned, you know, that I wasn't going to wake up. And I did wake up. I woke up in horrendous pain. I woke up in a bed, you know, covered in my own feces and urine, and also with the worst withdrawal symptoms I could possibly have because I had been out for so long. And it was just this wretched experience of just, what? I can't even kill myself. What is this? Are you kidding me? You know? And I had a really crazy experience where my drug dealer, who I had paid at the time to kind of go out and, you know, get me my next fix, he asked if his girlfriend could stay in the room with me while he went out as kind of a street collateral type thing. I'm going to come back with your money because she's here type deal. And she came in, and I remember her very vividly. She was probably between, you know, an African woman between 50 and 55. And she had a silvery, shiny wig on, definitely like golden, sparkly lipstick, you know, dressed up because she was a prostitute, and that was what she did. And she came in to sit with me, and she sat across the bed while, you know, I was just like literally writhing in pain, and she smoked crack cocaine, and I just sat there just suffering, waiting for this man to, you know, come back so I could be alleviated. And out of nowhere, she puts down the pipe and she reaches over and she puts her hand on me and she says, I've never had this happen to me before, but I just got to tell you, I just heard a voice and it told me to tell you that you're going to be okay. You're going to be okay. You really need to hear me. You're going to be okay. I don't know where it's coming from. And she was quite, you know, a little tripped out that this was coming through. And to me, in that moment, I just broke down, you know. Mm-hmm. I just broke down, and I got ripped off. That was it. I never saw those drugs, and I walked, you know, into a indigent rehab shelter about four blocks from there because I had nothing left. I had nowhere to go. I had nothing, mm-hmm. and I couldn't even kill myself. And so, to that extent, it was like, all right, I guess this is the next level. And then it went day by day after that. One day you conquer, you know. When you have one day of sobriety after being, you know, on drugs for so long, it's this like chaotic, laughable, you know, maniacal, just, oh my God, I can't believe I made it, but it's only one day, you know, and then those days start stacking onto each other. And before you know it, you got 30 days. And before you know it, you got a few months. And before you know it, you're starting to change your lifestyle a bit. You're starting to get, you know, your life back. You're doing things that are productive again. You're starting to let go of a lot of the shame and the humiliation that comes with that. And, you know, soon enough, you're looking back. And for me, you know, I'm looking back on two great kids, building my own business, you know, writing a lot of really wonderful, amazing music, you know, working within a movement for truth right now, and life is good. But there is not a day that goes by that I don't think about it or daydream about it.
Right. We do have some questions, if that's okay, to dive into.
Definitely.
We're in our last half hour here. We have a question in regards to cannabis. And how do you feel about cannabis? This is to the panel. And they said, I suppose anything can become addictive in a way, but it seems to be very beneficial in many ways. I don't know. Share your opinions if you'd like or not. But just curious. So how do you fellas feel about cannabis?
I'll jump in on this one. I would say that any behavior that we do that is not consciously invoked is an addictive behavior. Okay, so it leads to addiction. So, for example, if you're doing something and you're not really invested in what you're doing, well, now that is could be classified as an impulse, and you're just kind of working off of a program without actually consciously determining if that program is in alignment with yourself. So that idea of addiction, I would actually argue that the way most people understand food and how they eat food is at that level.
Definitely.
You know, when you ask people, why do you eat the food you eat? They're like, well, it tastes good. Translation, it makes me feel good. I don't understand why, but I know that it makes me feel good, and that's why I do it, which is the exact same mentality an addict uses to do the behavior they do.
Okay.
Okay, so That being said, I think marijuana has a lot of health benefits. I'll be honest, and I tell you that I smoke almost every day at the end of the day. And but on the other hand, there are some hindrances. So one of the issues with marijuana is that it does create a dopamine and serotonin dependency in the brain. Mm-hmm. So the brain chemistry is altered for at least 3 days after you smoke. And even if you're not quote unquote high the next day, you're not functioning at 100% capacity, which means you're going to yearn for that high that you just experienced the night before. And that is definitely, it will lead to an addictive type of behavior. Mm-hmm. That being said, I do think there's benefits to everything. Remember, it's all about invoking and unlocking hidden aspects of consciousness within yourself, which all kinds of experiences do for you. It's not just the drug experiences. So the real task is to analyze and get in yourself and ask yourself, well, what is this experience doing for me? Why am I doing it? Why am I yearning for it? And then once you've actually got that understanding, it's a little easier to know whether or not you're doing something addictive or not. And marijuana is, I would say, is definitely one of these ones that people kind of blanket with this, well, nobody can die from it because nobody has died from it. They've been trying to kill people and animals for decades and they still haven't succeeded. So because of that and all the health benefits, people kind of think, oh, well, it's great. I can do whatever I want with it. But I don't think that's actually the case, and I'll leave it there.
And I totally, you know, feel the same way too, that with marijuana in general, there are huge healing properties to it, you know, and topically, like I use it in topical creams for, you know, physical body aches, and it's amazing, you know, and I know people that have got off of, you know, pharmaceuticals, heavy painkillers by using marijuana, you know, where I grew up is a huge cultivation community of people that, you know, were at the front lines of developing medicine from this stuff, you know, things that like Phoenix Tears and the CBDs that are, you know, refinements that are coming out right now to kind of assist things with cancer. I mean, all different types of stuff, you know, seizures. It's amazing the stuff that's coming out of that. But what I do want to say too is that anything, you know, when does it become, when does it move away from a ritual space to a habit, to habitual? When does that happen where you cross the line of it becoming an addiction in excess when everything's extreme, you know? And so the idea of marijuana, like any drug, food, exercise, heroin, pharmaceuticals, these are, you know, these are things that need to be taken in moderation, and moderation is the key to understanding that kind of relationship with strong substances, with anything that can be able to create an altered state with you. And, you know, marijuana is one of those things that, you know, is looked at as a kind of harmless drug, but in the same way, it is also, you know, it can be an expression of addiction through, you know, being extreme and by using it continually, you know?
Right.
Oh, are you guys, can you guys hear me? Just checking.
I feel like we're floating through digital space land right now.
I know that we're having,
you know, some connection issues here. So for everybody that's, you know, kind of following along, but okay. I think we've all floated back now. Is that true?
Okay. I can sort of hear you, Emma. Can you all hear me?
I can hear you.
I can hear you guys too. It's a little choppy, but I can make you out. So I think we should just run with it.
All right. Can our audience, our listeners in chat, could you please tell us if we are coming in clear for you? I tell you what, Skype. All right. So what I will do is go ahead and ask the next question, if that's okay.
Yes.
All right. Okay. What do you personally use to ease and or disable, person wasn't sure on the right words, which is totally fine, the fight-flight response? What do we personally use to ease, disable that fight-flight response? Mm. It's a great question.
Yeah.
Do you want to take one, Yvonne? You have
sure.
Your something?
Oh, okay. Sure. Thank you. No problem. Okay. For me, I'm I know from my experiences, the old Ivan, and the reason why I say that is for listeners, I'm still healing from an actual event, which is a traumatic brain injury. The old Ivan loved fight flight. Loved. But the me now, I stay in the moment, and this didn't happen overnight. You take deep breaths, you meditate, but if there is a situation, anything is a situation, and before with using, I would gobble down pills for anything. It didn't matter. Just getting up in the morning, I would gobble down pills. So now, what do? I acknowledge what I am doing, and I hope you all can hear me, because, yes.
I can hear you.
Okay,
yeah.
Just making sure.
Yeah.
I acknowledge what I'm gonna do, what I want to do. I stay in the now. It's okay. It is human. It is the experience to feel nervous, to feel anxious, to feel sad, happy, mad, to feel that you don't fit in. It's okay. This is the experience.
Yeah.
So you have to absorb it. You have to breathe into it, and you have to say, hey, to yourself, hey, I'm feeling nervous. I'm going on air with my friends tonight. I'm feeling nervous. And you know what? That's okay. This is normal. Mm-hmm. So I talk to myself. I ground myself. I stand in earth, in the dirt. It's important for me to verbalize and to tell myself it's okay. This is the experience. You are in it. You are a part of it. This is what the experience is. So be in it. Do it. Nip it in the bud, so to speak. And through that, there is so much growth, not just with yourself, but when people that are used to my old Yvan, the fight flight, right? They're, oh gosh, here we go, right? It's not that anymore. It's, whoa, she's really taking in consideration. They see the difference. And your vibration, your energy, it's a control of the energy as well. Just breathe into it. This is the experience. That's what I do.
Awesome.
Mm-hmm.
How about you, Justin?
Definitely echo everything you just said, Yvonne. I think if we're talking about the fight or flight responses like anxiety or just feeling fear in general, there's two general methods I would say for that. The easiest method, depending on what the situation is, to just get out of the situation.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that'll give you some temporary calmness, and that's perfectly okay. The more lasting solution is to transmute the thing that actually triggers the fear in the first place. So, for example, you may fear heights. So one way to deal with fearing heights is to expose yourself to heights, face your fear, start to embrace the truth of what's happening, and really invoke a consciousness of gratitude for the fact that you even have that experience. And that will slowly start to transmute the definition that you've put in your mind. But sometimes you can't bite off more than you can chew, and you just gotta just pull back and find a place of safety and just get calm and centered and do some meditation. So those are my two biggest techniques right there.
Definitely. Those are all great. And, you know, for me really quick, reach out, you know, you reach out to people, build yourself a network of people that can understand. You know, that's why groups like AA are important. You know, I know a lot of people have, you know, their own opinions about the book and about the 12 steps. And I'm going to leave my opinions about those out of here too, just because they help some people, they don't help others, you know. But what I did appreciate about those groups is that they did give you a social sober group of people to then create relationships with in case of those places. Because when you're reaching out in those kind of times of fight or flight, especially with addiction and whatnot, you know, it really helps for somebody that has been through that to kind of be there as that baseboard. Because when you're talking someone down or you're connecting with somebody on that level, you know, for you again to know that they understand, you know, it's not just a logical, you know, breakdown of, okay, what are you going through? What are the symptoms you're going through? How do we address these symptoms? It's heart-centered consciousness that allows that connection to happen and help others. And so, you know, the idea of being of service and reaching out to friends that are having, you know, drug addiction problems. I've lost many friends, you know, I've lost many friends in very sad ways. And some of them I've been close to right up until the very end trying to help them, and they've still died. And that is kind of what it is, you know, that is that experience. And for the ones that have kind of made it out and started to rebuild the structures in their lives to protect themselves from destructive behavior like that, you know, you offer that connection to others that are in those places of needing that help, you know. So that's my suggestion to anybody on that level. Reach out to somebody that can understand.
Thank you, Emma, and thank you, Justin. Our next question is, how much of recovery do you think is down to having a better option possible? Is it a matter of some just not seeing a way out, or in your opinion, is there always one?
Do you mind me leading on this, you guys?
Go for it.
Go ahead.
This touches bases on a really broad topic. And, you know, originally I wanted to talk about in the first hour the black budget funding of CIA projects and things like that that comes from the sale of drugs and the drug war in itself. But really essentially, you know, for me, what it comes down to is the environment we agree to live in each day is a oppressive one. Each day we're subject to getting up against our own desires, doing things that we wouldn't normally choose if we had the freedom to, and existing under a level of oppression. On top of that, all the different types of influences on an emotional level, you know, on a physical level, from the foods and the, you know, carcinogens in the air, everything around our environment, how it affects our physical body, you know, the type of dialogue, the type of divisive, you know, energy that's, you know, propagated and supported in the world, how that hits us on an emotional level. You know, all of us are trudging around in a pretty rough experience right now. And so all of us on that level are seeking a place of, you know, peace, and some people find it, you know, in more functional ways than others, you know. And so when it comes down to recovery, it's that little place of victories again. Where do you find the little victories in your life? And there's also a mirror there for you to look at this existing system and how you want to change this. You know, the world that we're living in right now is ripe and fertile for change. And all of us are feeling that. And anybody that's tapped into the pulse of the world right now, you can kind of understand that and feel that. We are all aching for change. We are all miserable in this experience here. And so changing our environment is absolutely key to finding peace, you know. And when you talk about it in the context of recovery, you know, and getting change, it's a mirror for that same experience. Where do you change the little things in your life, your daily routines, little habits, finding little victories, taking little coups to be able to co-create your own life and, you know, become that reality, you know, projector out into the whole of projecting the best type of reality that you can for yourself, and literally, you know, breaking all of the social, you know, religious constructs that have locked us down into the thinking that this world is how it is and it has to stick this way. It's the same thing with drug addiction. You know, you're a drug addict and you're stuck being an addict, and this is just how it is. No, oh, where are those little victories that you can take each day to start reprogramming this paradigm for yourself, reprogramming it for the whole, mirroring it to people around you, dialoguing about it, sharing experiences, letting other people witness the changes that you do within your life. You know, when you see somebody that's been through drug addiction and they've made it on the other side, you know, that's something that inspires people more so than, you know, just around addiction. They see the power of being able to be resolute and the courage that it takes to kind of get through that. I know many people that I see, you know, that haven't seen me in, you know, 15, 18 years are shocked to know that I'm even still alive, you know?
Right.
That's real. Where are the little victories in your life that you can move forward to kind of create a new life for yourself and represent that to the outside world?
Right. And I'm going to step in here for a sec because this might throw some people off with what I'm about to say about having a better option. One of the terms that we've heard for a while now, and it's not that I agree or disagree, but this is where I'm leaning. I dislike the term disease, that addiction is a disease.
Me too.
Because that word disease is just that. It is infectious. And it is absorbed in your mind and your soul. And do not be defined by that word disease. That is how I feel. Yes, there is always a better option. So it aggravates me when, and I'm not saying it is not a disease or it is. Do you know what I mean? I'm saying just that word alone is training the masses. Hey, guess what? This is normal. This is a disease. You got it and you're stuck with it.
Right.
Well, you know what? I'm not going to be defined that way or put in a box by society's diagnosis. Mm-hmm. I won't. So there you go.
Right. Yeah. And I'll just, to add to the final comments on this question is, I think the other option, like you were just mentioning, is to change the definitions in yourself of what these experiences are.
Mm.
And realize, instead of thinking about it like a disease, think about it like you're an embryo that's about to be birthed into a new version of you is about to be birthed. I know that's one experience I had is, I spent that year really digging into myself and really understanding myself. And what I got out of those experiences was a level of personal knowledge and understanding that I'm still drawing from to this day. So I start to really embrace these experiences. And then the other thing is that impulsive behavior, feeding into impulsive behavior, is something you can work on in all respects in your life. So basically, instead of thinking about trying to tackle your addiction as only about whatever it is, the thing that you say you're addicted to, think about it in terms of any impulse. Just learn in through observing yourself when you have an impulsive idea pop into your mind, and then start that process of consciously analyzing it and saying, okay, well, I just had this impulse to go get, I don't know, McDonald's, or I just had this impulse to do something. And is this something that's really in alignment with myself? Is this really in alignment with my highest ideal and my spiritual purpose? Mm-hmm. And if it's not, then start to cultivate the bravery and the confidence to eventually transcend that so you can have these little victories. You know, one last thing I'll mention on this topic is that the mind is a singularity. Consciousness is a singularity. So whatever you work on in one place is going to affect all the other places in your life, including mm-hmm. addiction. And I'll leave it at that.
Mm-hmm. Wonderful. We are, hey, we're getting in another question. We have 7 minutes left. I cannot remember if there's a show right after this or if we can go over. Colleen.
All right, let's try rapid fire through it.
Okay, here we go.
You can go.
Care to discuss getting away from codependency? Nova Fiction, thank you for the question. Let me reiterate. Care to discuss getting away from codependency?
I mean, that's an addiction in itself, you know, and Justin mentioned that earlier. Essentially, you know, codependency is that. And, you know, there are a lot of people that I witness in my life, you know, And maybe everyone is wrapped up in codependency to a certain extent, and that's a great topic or a great insight to even kind of think about. Mm-hmm. You know, and how to get away from it. Well, one, recognizing it right away that you're involved in codependency is kind of step one. You know, the biggest thing about codependency, at least from my understanding, is it can go camouflage for a long time. You know, it takes a while to really kind of understand, oh dang, this is a codependent relationship, because there's so many emotional things that get kind of wrapped up into the experience of codependency. And usually codependency, you know, to me, it relates to people that are really close to you in your life, you know, or things that are close to you in your daily life. And so, you know, it's easy for those things to hide in those places. So to me, that's a step number one is, you know, looking at it and recognizing, okay, I have a codependent relationship. And then two, learning about it. There's a lot of great literature. A book that comes to mind is that I've read is A Codependent No More, and that gave me a lot of understandings of my codependent relationships that I have been in the past, and how to manage those tendencies within myself too.
And I did get the okay from Colleen. If we go over some time, that's okay, folks. So if you have more to add to that, Emma, please do so.
I don't, and I actually, for me, time-wise, I got two little girls that I got to shoo off the
bed. You bet. Okay, no problem.
Yeah, I'll just add that one little idea that really helped me understand my own codependency was the opposite of codependency. So if you're not codependent, you're interdependent with somebody, which means you're not dependent on them or something. So for example, if you need to have a certain person with you at all times, anytime you go out, well, there you go. That's a codependency. And if you imagine not having that and that causes you to feel anxiety or trepidatious or maybe uneasy, well, now you know there's probably some codependency there to look at. And if you take that simple exercise and you apply it to everything in your life, you will be shocked at how many things you're actually codependent with. And I'll leave it at that.
Okay. And for me, it depends. I'm just going to say it depends on the, I understand what codependency is, but in order to answer the question to discuss getting away from it, it depends on the situation and the how to's. It would apply to what that situation is that you're getting away from. So it is 7:56, my friends.
Do you think we have time for one more?
Do we have any more questions out there, or does anybody have any? We could definitely do another show about this down the road.
I thought there was another question.
Let me double check. That was it.
Perfect. So well, I think maybe we should just go ahead and close it out then.
Go ahead. Yeah. You want to do it and explain? Well, how about this? Next month's topic. So that's going to, we are in June now. So June 30th, right? Will be the next Looking Out From Within show. We do have a group on Facebook, Looking Out From Within. Please, if you'd like to take part in the Facebook group, please request to join that group. Our topic for the last Thursday of the month in June, the 30th, is transhumanism with guest Jim Nichols. And what we are going to do, Emma, would you like to explain how we're going to handle the chat in Looking Out From Within? Okay.
Definitely.
And the question. Okay.
So the group is essentially made for the community to contribute their ideas and topics and links prior to the show. And what it allows Justin and Yvonne to do is to be able to kind of feel the pulse of the community out there that is interested in kind of following the show and following these topics. And what we would encourage you all to do is strike up dialogue on this. We'll be posting a link within the group around the next show with the heading, and under that feed is where we encourage the dialogue to happen. And feel free to, you know, write what your opinions are about transhumanism. Feel free to post links or reference material there. And what that does is it serves as a pool for Justin and Yvonne to be able to engage with the host who has a particular, you know, savvy towards a topic. And in this case, it's Jim Nichols, and he's been working, you know, recently on the topic of transhumanism and has a lot to say about it. And so these guys can then pull from a community pool of questions and dialogue to engage Jim with on that level. And so anybody that's going following along through Facebook, they can just look up Looking Out From Within as a group, and we'll add you in there and feel free to contribute to the feed.
Wonderful, Emma, and thank you. Thank you very much for being a part of our premiere show here. Justin, do you have any last minute words?
Other than I'm very grateful for the opportunity to contribute and give back. I've been greatly empowered by the sharings and experiences of others, and I feel it's my duty and my joy to give back. So thank you everybody for that opportunity.
Yeah, absolutely. And I'd like to thank Colleen Kelly behind the scenes here at HaggyShack.com, Haggy Shack Radio. She is our lovely producer tonight and the opportunity to let us all gather here. And I want to thank the universe for having us here too, because, you know, with the topic tonight, we could all not be here very easily.
Without a doubt.
So thank you, universe, for this wonderful, wonderful meeting. And again, I hope you all tune in next month we are in June. We kind of messed up that date, didn't we, a little bit, but the last Thursday of the month, we will be here talking about transhumanism. I hope you tune in tomorrow night for the Groovy Bean Show at 6 p.m. Pacific time. We're going to have Isaac Weishaupt on from IlluminatiWatcher.com. Folks, if you want to know more about the Illuminati, about symbolism, about how they get you in the movies and music, please tune in. And again, thank you all, Haggy Shack and chat room and all those in the Facebook chat as well, from looking out from within. I'm Yvonne Palermo, and good night, everyone. Thank you again.
Good night.
Good night, everybody.
Emma Gold, full disclosure now. At 6 p.m. Pacific, 9 p.m. Eastern. Live from the Cascadian Ring of Fire, hosted by Yvonne Palermo. We are all beings, groovy little seeds, here to feed the planet. Haggy Shack Radio, where the sheep don't sleep and the truth comes from within. HaggyShack.com.